Luke, the 5th chapter and the 25th verse. Immediately, he stood up. The song Stand Up by Ludacris off his 4th studio album, Chicken and Beer, was produced by Kanye West and is known as one of the most iconic videos in Luda's career. He could be seen in the club with his Nike shoe, y'all just saw it, stumping his feet, telling everybody to stand up. And he immediately follows that line by saying, when I move, you move, just like that. This is a hit record that most of us who grew up between the 90s and the 2000s will remember. Ludacris, Stand Up. And in the video, there's this cast of characters who seem to shine when usually they would not have the opportunity to. In the same way, we find a man in our text today who had yet to have his opportunity to stand up. I don't know who I'm preaching to on today, but I believe that God is about to allow you to experience a breakthrough that you've been patiently waiting for. I'm not sure who's tapped into the stream, but somebody's been waiting for a serious miracle. And I want to encourage you with this word on today. It is your time to stand up. As we tiptoe towards our text today, we see Jesus shooting his regular. He walks up on some fishermen, and as soon as he arrives, they receive a net-breaking blessing that they were fishing for a long time. And when Jesus comes, it seems all the fish jumped into their net. Y'all know what grandma used to say, it. He may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. And a little later, after Jesus gives them this net breaking blessing, he heals a leper and tells him, he says, bruh, tell nobody what I've done. In essence, what he's saying is, don't go bragging about what I've done for you. Just let people know who I am. After all of that, Jesus goes to pray, and we find ourselves in Luke, the 5th chapter and the 17th verse. It reads, one day Jesus was teaching, and Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there. They had come from every village of Galilee and from Judea and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was with Jesus to heal the sick. Okay, what the text does, it gives us time and place. Time and place, the place they are geographically positioned in Galilee. The time, it is one day. And it also lets us know that the power of the Lord was there. They were geographically positioned in Galilee. That's the place. The time, it says one day, and the power of the Lord was there. It's interesting to me that the scripture says it was one day. I don't believe there's any wasted ink in scripture. And Luke, the author of our text, he says it was one day. Now, I'm married, and sometimes I come home and I bring my wife some flowers. Sometimes I'll stop at Juice It Up and surprise her with her favorite drink. Sometimes I'll show up with her favorite type of meal. I just do it, and it's not anything special. It's just one day I feel like it. It's just one day. One day out the week, I may just show up with a gift. But truth be told, if I don't show up with a gift, she's not upset because it's just one day. But there are other days that are not just some day and one day. I cannot show up empty handed on Valentine's Day. I cannot show up empty handed on our anniversary. Those are not just some day. Those are very special days. And when you read the book of Exodus, y'all stay with me now. The 20th chapter, starting at the 8th verse, it says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy servant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor the stranger that is within the city gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath and hallowed it. It was the responsibility of the Jew to honor the Sabbath day. It was their responsibility to recognize the Sabbath. The fact that Luke references this day as just one day lets us know there was nothing special about the day that Jesus was in that house. These people worship on the Sabbath, yet Luke references this as one day. What are you trying to say to us, Pastor? I'm glad you asked. Don't wait on Sunday. Whatever you need from God, don't think you have to wait on some special day or some special moment. If this past year has taught us anything, it's that we can't wait to show up in the church building to get our blessing. We cannot wait until Pastor is standing on that stage to receive something from God. You need to say, God, I need something now. If it's a Friday, I need something now. Somebody who likes 80s music, y'all heard it before. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. So sometimes you have to say, Lord, it's not Sunday, but I need something. I'm not in the middle of the church building. I'm not sitting in the seat that I usually sit in, but I need something from you. Miracles are not manufactured on special days. Miracles are not manufactured on special days. It does not have to be a Sunday. It does not have to be a service. We don't have to be in revival. It can just be one day. And that can be the day that God moves in your life. Quit looking for a superstar pastor in order for you to get your blessing. Quit looking for some powerful prophet to show up in your town in order for you to get what you need from God. The power of God to heal can be wherever you are. Luke, the 5th chapter and the 17th verse, we read it. It says the power of God was in their house. I don't know where you're watching this. I don't know where you're hearing this sermon, but the power of God is right there in your car. The power of God is right there in your kitchen. The power of God is right there in your living room. The power of God is right there in line at Starbucks. It's not about a day or time. It's not about this perfect place. The scripture says that these people were in one house. Jesus was teaching and his power was there. It's a regular day, but they have Jesus. It's a regular day, but they have the Prince of Peace. It's a regular day, but they have with them the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. At the place where they live, the God who gives life is in their presence. I'm so glad that I have Jesus with me. And let's look at what these folks had to say while Jesus was in their midst. The 21st verse, it says the Pharisees and the teachers of the law began thinking to themselves, who is this fellow who speaks blasphemy? Who can forgive sins but God alone? Okay, y'all are missing it. Jesus is there. He's performing miracles and they begin to question him. The God who can solve all problems, instead of them bringing their problems to him, that they begin to question him. Jesus is there and they are bystanders on the sideline. He's present. And instead of connecting with that power, they're on the sideline questioning him. Oh, OK, I'm sensing there's some cognitive disconnect between the preacher and the pew. I sense that maybe there's a disconnection between what I'm saying and where you're sitting. So let me try it a different way. I grew up in the early 90s. And I remember there was a time that my teacher would bring out what we called a parachute. And you knew that you were having a good day at school when your teacher brought out that parachute. Some of y'all kids don't know nothing about this. They're tablet babies. But back in the day, we used to have to go outside and actually play. We had things like recess, and in recess we played handball and kickball. And on special days, our teacher would bring out a parachute. It's not something that we did often. It's not something that we did all the time. And I can't really explain the rules of the game. You just had to experience it. When they threw that parachute in the air. The way that you played that game, you had to make sure when that parachute went up that you went under it. The way to play the game, when that parachute went up, you had to get under it. You could not experience the game. You couldn't really even explain it unless you got under it. Oh, okay, these Pharisees and Sadducees were there. Jesus is geographically positioned in this house. His power to heal is there on one day, and they decide to be bystanders instead of making the conscious decision to get under his word. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but somebody watching this, you need to get under the word of God. Quit asking questions. Quit trying to see how it makes sense and how is it going to work, and just say, God, if you said it, that settles it. I'm going to get under your word. If the power of God to heal shows up, I'm going to get under that power. Oh, okay, y'all, please give me some pastoral privilege. I just read the 21st verse, but I want to double back to the 18th verse. I know I'm preaching backwards, but I promise this will bless you if you stay with me. The 18th verse says, some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. Okay, so these people are in a house with Jesus. His power to heal is in the house. And some men carry their friend to the house. They lift him on a roof, these men, and they drop him through a hole in the roof. This man is paralyzed. He couldn't do it on his own, but his friends carry him to the house. I want to give you a scripture, and I don't know if you've ever seen it like this, but I want you to start looking at it like this. Matthew, the 18th chapter and the 20th verse, it says, for where two or three gather in my name, there I am with them. Now, many of us who grew up in church, we've heard this scripture used during a failed service or a failed event. You have an event, you pass out the flyers, and when you all begin service, there's only three or four people in the building. So the host, the MC, the moderator gets up and says, well, you all know when two or three are gathered, he's in the midst. It's almost as if they're saying nobody's here, but we're going to steal half church anyway. And I want to encourage you, quit associating that with failed services and begin to associate that with this idea. I believe this scripture is for people who have vision. I believe this scripture is for people who have passion, that there are people who are doing something, that they're working towards something. And your thought is, I have a dream. I have a vision. And if only two or three people could get on board with what I'm doing, if only two or three people could show up and encourage me, if only two or three people could show up and invest in me, I want to speak this word over your life. God is about to send you those two or three people. God is about to send you somebody to lift you up. He's about to send you somebody to hold up your arms where two or three people are going to show up. They're going to confirm to you that God's favor is on your life in that area of your life. Somebody say, my two or three are coming. Luke, the fifth chapter in the 18th verse, it says, some men carrying a paralyzed man on a mat, that they tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. The 19th verse, I already paraphrased it. It says, when they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat through the tiles into the middle of the crowd right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, friend, your sins are forgiven. This man had no chance of getting to Jesus without those two or three people. If those two or three people never showed up, he would have never got to Jesus. It's interesting to me because as I look back over my life, I can think of people who broke my heart. I can think of people who I had expectations of and they did not meet those expectations. I can see some of the family stuff that I dealt with that I wish I was able to avoid. But as I take a step back, I realize if it had not been for those two or three people, would I love God how I love him now? If it had not been for those two or three people who did me wrong, would I be able to trust God like I trust him now? I believe some people, God sent them to you because they were on assignment to hurt you. And it was the fact that they hurt you that put you in position to receive total healing from God. Is it possible the only way that you were ever going to get what you needed from God was that somebody else had to let you down? And you're upset at them, not realizing they were the two or three that God sent to push you into his presence. Is it possible the stuff you went through with your father, God used him as one of the two or three to position you for your purpose? Some things God purposely allows us to go through so we can be positioned to be used by him. We got to go. Jesus tells this man, friend, your sins are forgiven. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees, instead of getting under that word, did they question his authority? Let's look at it. The 24th verse of Luke, the 5th chapter, it says, but I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. So he said to the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up, take your mat and go home. Now, I need you to understand something about this Jewish Hebraic culture at that time. They associated sickness with sinfulness. They thought if you had an ailment in your body, it was because of a failure in your lifestyle choice or your parents' lifestyle choice. Hear me. They associated sickness with sinfulness. So in their minds, this man was sick because of his sins. And what Jesus did, he said, you all want me to deal with a symptom, his sickness. But what I'm going to do is deal with the root, his sin. Yes, this man is paralyzed, but before I ever touch his body, I want to touch his soul. He said, before I ever heal him from his sickness, I'm going to free him from his sin. Here's my next point. Many of us have gone to church. We've prayed the prayer of salvation. Our sins are forgiven. But now that Jesus has dealt with the root, you've got to let go of that sin. My next point, please hear me when I say it. You've got to get up. Yes, you're not going to hell. You're on your way to heaven. God has freed you from your sins, but there is more to this life than salvation. You have to get up. God did not save you. Thank you, Christian, on our last episode of Text Talk. Shameless plug. Go watch it after you watch this. He said salvation is much more than fire insurance. God didn't want you to get a get out of hell free card. He has a plan and a purpose for you, and it's going to take for you to make the conscious decision to get up. Let's look at it. Luke, the 5th chapter and the 25th verse. It says, immediately he stood up. Immediately he stood up. Here's my whole sermon. Ludacris' 4th studio album, Chicken and Beer, produced by Kanye West, one of his biggest hit records, number one on the Hot 100 charts. Ludacris said on the song, it's the song title, stand up. And God sent me here today to give you this word. It's time for you to stand up. Thank you, Luda. He said, when I move, you move. Just like that. When I move, you move. Just like that. Look over your life and all that God has brought you from. He has been moving. And it's time for you to move. God is saying, I've moved. Now you move. just like that. I need somebody to hear me on today. You have been freed from your sins. And now God is saying it's time for you to get up and get moving. You're not on your way to hell, but you are experiencing hell in your life. And God wants you free from the pain of those struggles. He wants you free from the pain of that circumstance. And it's going to take for you to make a conscious decision in this time of your life to get up and get moving. Somebody here, there are issues in your relationship. Somebody here, there are issues on your job. I don't know exactly what you're dealing with, but what I want you to do is get that area of problem on your mind. Get that struggle you've been dealing with on your mind. And I'm going to pray for you. Partner your faith with mine. And let's pray. Father, today, I'm grateful for each and every individual that's watching this service. And I'm praying, Lord, that we receive what you're telling us today. That we get under your word. That we can stand up. And Lord, as you moved in our life, we believe by faith you have released us to move. You've given us the power to overpower this thing we've been dealing with. Lord, bring your strength and favor into our relationships. Bring your strength and favor into our finances. Bring your healing power into our bodies. But Lord, we're not just believing for some supernatural move where we don't join in the resolution. Lord, our faith will be mixed with our works, and we'll trust you with a plan of action. Lord, we'll do our best to live right, to love right, to forgive, to extend grace. And as we live out our faith, God, we are believing for the breakthrough, that we will no longer be paralyzed by our problems. God, I declare the turnaround. I declare the healing. I declare the freedom that these people need. And we thank you for it now that is showing up in our lives, even on this Sunday. Even whenever we watch the stream, it shows up within the next 24 hours. And we thank you that it is so. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank God and amen. Listen, I love you. My wife loves you. But most importantly, God loves you. And his word for you today is stand up. When he moves, you move. Just like that. Wherever you're watching from, however you came across this video, I don't believe this is by accident. And I want to take time to extend an opportunity for salvation. You may be saying, Pastor Lance, I've given my life to Christ, but I'm not where I'm supposed to be. You may be saying, Pastor, I've never truly given my life to him. Or you may say, hey, I know I'm saved, but I just want to make sure that I'm exactly where God wants me to be, wherever you find yourself on that spectrum. I want to pray this prayer with you. Will you just repeat after me? Say, Lord, I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I believe that you died on the cross and that you rose again on the third day. And when you got up, I got up. I thank you, Lord, for saving me, taking me out of this and this out of me, and I'll never be the same another day in my life. I am saved. If you prayed that prayer with a sincere heart, you are saved. And don't let anybody talk you out of that. And remember this, there is a process to your progress. So you just take it one step at a time and watch how God, I say it all the time, I'll say it again, will make the rest of your life the best of your life. I hope you have a wonderful week. God bless.